Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books presents By Hands Now Known, Jim Crow's Legal Executioners by Margaret A. Burnham. Read by Diana Blue. Introduction. The black man is a person who must ride Jim Crow in Georgia. W.E.B. Du Bois. In June 1944, a person named Sam Rayburn sent a letter to the New York office of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People about a death in Donelsonville, Georgia. An elderly Negro woman had been examining a can of oil at a general store. The white man in charge told her to put the can down. She did so, then turned, perhaps on her heels, and left. The man, whose age Rayburn put at about 20, followed her from the store onto the street and beat her with an axe handle, causing her death. Rayburn, the letter writer, did not name the victim or the perpetrator, but did say it was rumored that the white man had been arrested and promptly released. Donelsonville, the letter continued, is a small town completely isolated. Please intercede if there is any possible chance. A lawyer for the NAACP, likely overworked, advised Rayburn to look to local authorities or Georgia's governor, Eugene Talmadge, for an investigation. Rayburn's letter was all that kept this incident from disappearing into thin air. It never made it into any newspaper or historical account. Remaining a mystery is the name of the killer, although the extant legal records allow us to say with some confidence that he was never prosecuted. We know nothing, not the race nor the gender of Sam Rayburn. In 2020, researchers learned that the victim was one Ollie Hunter, that she was in her mid-60s, and that she was likely single when she was killed. If there was any legal process in Donelsonville, it appeared not to have been preserved. The case never reached federal authorities. Scanty though the facts are, they suggest how lethal, for women and for men, the most commonplace encounters under Jim Crow could be. And they tell us something about the role of law, for they suggest that the dispute mechanisms that are at the heart of the country's sense of exceptionalism, reliance on neutral laws and evidence-based determinations, yielded to a strikingly different system under Jim Crow. What cultural norm did Ollie Hunter violate? Did she curse the store manager, throw the can onto the counter, exit the store too quickly? Was there bad blood between the two? Who was the killer? Did he raise his family in Donelsonville after the murder? Did his descendants remain there? Who were the local journalists who deemed the case too trivial to report? The prosecutor who, so far as we can tell, let the case die? We are left to speculate on details and motives. But what we do know about the slaying tells us a great deal about the role of direct physical violence in sustaining Jim Crow. Based on these facts, at that time and place, the transgressor was the black elderly woman, not the young white grocer, and her sentence was death. Although much has been written about the South in general, and Southern Jim Crow in particular, the system of white supremacy that prevailed between the late 19th and mid-20th century is ancient history for the current generation. They may recognize the names Rosa Parks and Fred Shuttlesworth and know something about lynching, but they likely have little sense of the quotidian violence that shaped routine experiences like grocery shopping and tied the nation's legal institutions to its racial culture. Much of that history was never preserved. The chronic, unpredictable violence that loomed over everyday black life dictating the movements and postures of white store owners and black customers, is what sustained Jim Crow for over half a century. Conflating private and public authority and immunizing whites who served as its unofficial policemen, like the grocer, Jim Crow blurred the lines between formal law and informal enforcement. C. Van Woodward captured this in his 1955 classic, The Strange Career of Jim Crow. The Jim Crow laws put the authority of the state or city in the voice of the streetcar conductor, the railway brakeman, the bus driver, the hoodlum of the public parks and playgrounds. Although closely correlated with life in the postbellum South, Jim Crow took different forms across the country, embedded in culture, articulated in law, and entrenched in politics. Often portrayed as defining a strictly dualistic system with segregation on the one hand and integration on the other, Jim Crow was as pervasive in northern spaces where no signs demarcated racial positioning as it was in southern spaces where the races rubbed elbows but occupied different worlds. It was not so much tied to a geographical place as it was a national project, supported not just by the violence of the locals, but by a national legal system that endorsed and sustained a missionary commitment to a future of perpetual white rule. While researchers have examined the history of the Jim Crow regime and its contemporary footprint, particularly in the realm of criminal justice, the erasure of important parts of this narrative, Ollie Hunter's case and those like it, leaves us with crucial gaps in our understanding of the period. Using newspaper accounts, courtroom testimony, legislation, and judicial rulings, by hands now known, addresses those gaps. It seeks to illuminate how direct physical violence, a defining feature of Jim Crow, shaped the legal terrain in the South during the first half of the 20th century, transforming in fundamental ways concepts of federalism, citizenship, and democratic rights and privileges. Neither sporadic nor irrational, but rather inescapable and uncontrolled, the violence was a marker of legal personhood and freedom. Its ideologies and constructions of racialized masculinity, of black pain, suffering, and silence, of color-coded public spaces, of Southern redemption, have endured into the present. As a uniquely American phenomenon, the mob violence that riddled the Southern landscape, from Appomattox until World War II, indubitably epitomized racial vulnerability. But the national obsession with lynching has also obscured the mundane, largely hidden violence that, while it lay at a different point on the spectrum, was equally essential to Jim Crow. Twice erased is the murder of Ollie Hunter, submerged seamlessly into the landscape of Southern life at the moment of her death, and then omitted brutally from historical accounts of the period. The early to mid-20th century was a critical period in solidifying white supremacy and incorporating its premises into legal codes and practices. This study of the Jim Crow legal system examines the experiences ordinary citizens had with the police, prosecutors, and courts. It draws on cases, some well-known and many, like that of Ollie Hunter, newly discovered, that have been collected by researchers at Northeastern University and the Massachusetts Institute of Technology under my direction and that of MIT political scientist Melissa Nobles, my research partner. In 2007, Nobles and I set out on a journey to unearth this forgotten history of racially motivated homicides for the families, of course, But we also wore our scholars' hats as we did the work. Without these accounts, we thought, we could not fully map the Jim Crow system in the United States, or grasp how it seeped deep into the interstices of the U.S. legal system, or the precise content of its residue today. Without them, we could not measure the scope and nature of authoritarianism in the southern states, or the patterns and dynamics of black resistance. We knew that these histories had been largely ignored in official accounts of the period. But as we traveled across the country and visited with families, we met with hundreds of people who insisted on keeping these memories alive for their own posterity. Preserving photographs and old newspaper clippings, they cultivated a kind of vernacular history that they were eager to share with us. Despite these individual efforts, however, a careful account of lethal state violence remained unavailable to a wider public. It was our sense that, as long as these events translated as idiosyncratic, one-off, private experiences of grief, multifaceted systems of racial injustice would remain hidden, and, concomitantly, the need for structural remedies would seem unwarranted. We brought together our professional expertise and the critical work that community historians were doing to compose a more comprehensive and accurate picture. To track these cases, we created a database of racial violence incidents, namely homicides, in the U.S. South during the Jim Crow era. We narrowed our scope to the South, fully mindful of the myth of Southern exceptionalism, simply because so much of the violence occurred there. We chose the mid-20th century because we wanted to capture the memories of elderly family members, and because we had access to federal records from that period. A good deal had already been written about the racial violence of the traditional civil rights era. Jim Crow era violence, on the other hand, had not been fully treated when we began our research. When we called survivors from the period, they often responded, "I thought I'd never get this call." The fruit of this project is the CRRJ Burnham Noble's Digital Archive, a collection of public documents and interviews that capture, through over 1,000 homicides, the grim history of anti-black violence in the Jim Crow South. Drawing, in part, on these archival materials, By Hands Now Known tackles the three interrelated themes of federalism, racial violence, and resistance. The federal government, including the Justice Department, had the legal tools to protect citizens from the most egregious forms of Jim Crow violence and a political duty to do so. But distance and denial severely undermined its response. In the mid-20th century, federal courts, oblivious to the long-term stakes, rendered nearly toothless the Reconstruction-era statutes that specifically targeted racist terror. The government failed to grasp that what they were dealing with was not just a criminal law problem, but a civil and human rights problem. Its failure to take the necessary steps to punish the violence constituted a breach of law and duty, even where the crimes were committed by private individuals. What tools were available to Washington, and why were they ineffective? What permanent scars to the legal system are attributable to these failures? And how did the Black Freedom Movement challenge this federal abandonment? Second, By Hands Now Known probes the dynamic relationship between violence, physical violence in contrast to symbolic or structural violence, political power, and citizenship during the Jim Crow era. These assaults both signified and solidified white male domination, repressed black political participation and economic competition, and unified whites across class lines. Violence mediated the transformation from slave property to citizenship in a free labor regime. White control, including violent suppression, was inherent in slavery, but after the Civil War, the country's ruling elites in both the North and the South were operating under a purportedly liberal democratic regime and therefore had to adopt different methods to control and exploit free labor. Violence that was previously lawful became putatively illegal. Nevertheless, from Reconstruction until the end of Jim Crow, black citizenship was profoundly shaped by the white terror that served to control black labor and mollify the white working class. The right to live free of violence, to have the legal wherewithal to protect one's property and person, was at the heart of the liberal, law-bound democratic project. Stripping black people of that right knocked them back to non-citizens. By Hands Now Known investigates these Jim Crow years of dashed hopes to illuminate how, after slavery was over, a self-described democratic republic used terror to revive a form of sub-citizenship that would prevail for just short of a century. It illustrates how authoritarian Southern political systems thrived within an ostensibly democratic national polity. Third, By Hands Now Known excavates the history of collective resistance to racial terror in the Jim Crow era. Historians have written much about the civil rights movement of the 30s and 40s and the continuities in anti-racist social movements across the 20th century. Nevertheless, the popular view persists that black protest, particularly in the South, was not especially robust or consequential until the late 1950s. The case studies here suggest otherwise. In September 1933, 4,000 people, aroused to a fever pitch, attended a protest funeral in Atlanta in the wake of the police shooting of 40-year-old Glover Davis, a blind man. With 90 police officers, some mounted, armed with machine guns and tear gas, encircling the church, the pastor forbade protest eulogies. In defiance, one minister intoned, "Lord, give us men who are not afraid to denounce police brutality and their slaying of Negroes, shooting them in the back while they flee arrest. Give us an aroused church, both white and black, who, despite mob violence, and even though the police force surround our churches, will stand upon the housetops and cry aloud." In 1942, 13 years before the Montgomery boycott, black bus passengers in Mobile, Alabama, threatened a walk to work, walk to church, walk to shop campaign, forcing the town's bus company to disarm their drivers after an operator shot and killed a soldier on his bus. And in 1948, 4,500 mine workers, black and white, staged a wildcat strike in Edgewater, Alabama, to protest the police killing of a popular 54-year-old black union man. Demonstrations such as these were but one form of black protest. Civil lawsuits filed by survivors of racial homicides offered detailed accounts of the events, as do petitions to public officials and letter-writing campaigns. These materials, the source of many of the cases examined in this book, evince sophisticated conceptions of the relationship between structural harms and police brutality, while also revealing significant divisions over politics and strategies. Though some civic and church leaders looked for consensus and favored top-down, deliberative approaches, militants, including many in the faith community, pushed back, rejecting the prevailing script of respectability and polite subordination. They worked from the ground up, centered the perspectives of those at the bottom, perceived it as absurd to lobby for legal change in lawless spaces, and argued that only bold contestation, which could include counter-violence and sabotage, would bring about change. Also key was the black press, without which many of these stories would have remained hidden. These big city newspapers, including the Chicago Defender, the Pittsburgh Courier, and the Baltimore Afro-American, transformed individual tragedies into collective experiences, nationalized black politics, and ignited the black imagination. In sum, these practices of protest altered legal meanings, challenged the state's pretensions to equal justice, fostered collective agency and solidarity, and dislodged official truths in favor of indigenous knowledge. These anti-Jim Crow activists lost as often as they won, but their travails, which tell us much about life under Jim Crow, comprise an essential umbilical link to the movements of the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. A 19th century federal case, United States versus Cruikshank, foreshadowed what was at stake in the 20th century struggle over federalism and citizenship. The case concerned a massacre that took place in Colfax, Louisiana, on Easter Sunday in 1873. When the guns fell silent in a confrontation over the results of an election pitting Republicans, black and white, against white Democrats, many of whom were former Confederate soldiers and members of groups like the Ku Klux Klan, three white men and somewhere between 60 to 150 black men were left dead, and the parish courthouse, the site of the siege, was virtually in ashes. Historian Eric Foner described this event in Majority Black Grant Parish as the bloodiest single instance of racial carnage in the Reconstruction era. It taught many lessons, he wrote, including the lengths to which some opponents of Reconstruction would go to retain their accustomed authority. Although 97 members of the white mob were indicted under federal law, only 9 were charged. Congress investigated the massacre and released a report describing it as a deliberate, barbarous, cold-blooded murder that was a foul blot on the page of history. But the appellate courts overturned all the ensuing convictions. The most harmful opinion came not from the U.S. Supreme Court, but from one of its justices, Joseph P. Bradley, who was sitting on the Federal Appeals Court along with 2 other judges. Bradley construed the laws that the Reconstruction Congress adopted to curtail racist terror in a manner that made it clear the federal courts would view with hostility any congressional efforts to confer all the elements of citizenship on the formerly enslaved. He read narrowly the constitutional grant of power to Congress to pass such laws. He reduced congressional power to hold individuals liable for civil rights violations. He heightened the prosecutor's burden in these cases by demanding proof of intentional discrimination. And, in effect, he reinforced the widely held belief that black people should not be permitted to bear arms, notwithstanding the Second Amendment. The long shadow cast over federal civil rights enforcements by Bradley's opinion, which was endorsed by the Supreme Court, has crippled civil rights enforcement to this day. In Louisiana, the reaction to Bradley's opinion was swift and brutal. Night riders in Colfax slit the throat of a black man named Frank Foster, who was disastrously in the wrong place at the wrong time. A few days later, one of the defendants in the Cruikshank trial, seemingly emboldened by the Bradley decision, helped an armed group force five Republican officials to leave their posts. Mob terror against Republicans picked up across the South, escalating the full-throttled project of violent redemption. The Cruikshank case was about more than the abstract theories of federalism and the separate powers of Congress and the courts. The limits on the constitutional authority of Congress to control racist violence changed the balance of power in favor of state and local police, prosecutors, and courts, who could thereafter enforce white supremacy without much fear of federal oversight. As the case is described in By Hands Now Known, _, the violent enactment of Jim Crow's precepts aligned with the unfettered power exercised by local police, elected sheriffs and their deputies in the rural South, police chiefs and their officers in the cities and towns. Slavery abides in all American institutions, but its formative and enduring presence in policing during Jim Crow was particularly palpable. Indeed, the unremitting lines between violent policing, slavery, and Jim Crow were pronounced well into the 21st century. It could be perceived in the violence that claimed the lives of Trayvon Martin, the teenager who in 2012 violated the white space rule, Sandra Bland, who in 2015 defied the never talk back to a white cop rule, and George Floyd, the tall black man whose mere existence was so irksome to a white officer that he felt entitled to perform a public execution in 2020. Such violence, at once calculated and casual, reconstructed the culture of policing from one generation to the next, from slavery through Jim Crow and beyond. Performance of power and degradation of black otherness, this alienation of black humanity, illegalization of black life, is just half of the story of the parallels between modern policing and slavery. Black communities have fought back, and that militant history, the other half of the story, establishes that protest against police violence has always been central to black social movements. From 1865 to the present, black people have identified law enforcement officers as perhaps their most potent existential threat. In the first year of the 20th century, a race riot broke out in New York City's Tenderloin District. The police force encouraged a mob intent on lynching. New York activists, who gathered the testimony of 80 victims, reported that it was the nightsticks of the police that sent a stream of bleeding colored men to the hospital. Led by T. Thomas Fortune, a prominent black journalist of the day, New Yorkers formed the Citizens Protective League to pursue prosecutions against the officers. The league was not successful, and the officers went back to their beats. That was more than a century ago, long before three black women coined the phrase, Black Lives Matter. Lawless police, acting on behalf of the state, has defined how black people experienced American law for two centuries, and, concomitantly, black struggles for citizenship and meaningful democratic participation have always included radical demands for relief from such state violence. By Hands Now Known explores what prevented the federal government from stepping in to control police brutality at the local level, why the Justice Department refused to craft an effective campaign to abate the terror, and how the federal courts exacerbated the problem, as had Justice Bradley in the Cruikshank case in the previous century. It is this pattern of non-enforcement that looks over our shoulders today, when in current times, the Department of Justice defers to state prosecutors and juries, and when the federal courts enfeeble civil rights remedies that might make victims whole, as they do by allowing police to escape civil liability by claiming immunity, they are calling up the old playbook. Hovering all around us in our August federal courts as much as in our county courtrooms is the law of Jim Crow and, as well, its antecedent, the law of slavery. The stories of the victims of Jim Crow and the communities that came to their aid anchor this account of racial violence and the legal system that fostered it. Important not only for what they teach us about Jim Crow, these stories point to an ideological debate about the American future that transcends the criminal legal system. The chapters that follow, organized in loosely chronological fashion, pursue the book's central questions by identifying specific themes, such as Jim Crow transportation during World War II, and by shining a spotlight on specific geographical areas like Birmingham and Southwest Mississippi. The subject of Part 1 is rendition, the legal process by which states make demands upon other states for the return of their citizens so that they may be subjected to criminal proceedings in the home state. The rendition conventions that emerged in the Jim Crow years were foreshadowed by the legal battles associated with the Underground Railroad. Together with the anti-lynching campaigns of crusaders like Ida Wells Barnett and Walter White, rendition cases in the 1920s, 30s, and early 40s created an opportunity for Southern and Northern authorities to advance different concepts of black citizenship, states' rights, and due process. These cases also knit together a national black community as migrants from the South reached back to help loved ones and neighbors escape the legal systems of the Southern states. The cases reveal how the legal practices of slavery were reprised in the successor Jim Crow regime, and offer a perspective on cross-state campaigns to liberate black men and women who were charged in the South and to then settle them in the growing metropolis commonly known as the Northern Ghetto. Part 2 canvasses World War II-era cases to relate the battles between black soldiers seeking to maintain their dignity and status as they traveled through the South and Jim Crow's gatekeepers, whether bus drivers, police officers, or white fellow riders. Like the first part, the chapters in Part 2 interrogate ideas about mobility as a feature of citizenship. The Justice Department and the War Department faced the question of whether black soldiers had to comply with local rules regarding segregated transportation. Instead of definitive national policies protecting the soldiers, the federal government prevaricated and, with some notable exceptions, left the terrain to local authorities who were actively hostile to black people in military uniforms. This part highlights an innovative example of politics from below, black women's creative defiance of Jim Crow's transportation, which undercut the legitimacy of the system, emboldened other black riders, and challenged presumptions of power. Part 3 offers an account of the establishment, in 1939, of a unit to address civil rights in the Justice Department and the challenges the department faced as it sought to reach violations buried deep in the South. To better grasp the flux and flow between federal policies and those of the states concerning civil rights criminal cases, the part follows the docket of a leading prosecutor in the federal Middle District of Alabama, which includes the capital city of Montgomery, once home to one of the country's busiest slave markets. The prosecutor began his career, appropriately enough, pursuing a sheriff who visited his brutality on blacks and whites alike. But his enthusiasm rather quickly waned as he confronted jury nullification. The part describes the suffering caused, in no small part, by this particular federal official's capitulation to local authorities and the measures taken in Washington to address the problem. Part 4 strips to the bone Supreme Court jurisprudence on racial violence to better appreciate the impact of the court's pronouncements on political relationships at the local level. In 1945, in the case Screws versus United States, the Supreme Court imposed a confusing intent requirement on the federal criminal civil rights statutes passed during Reconstruction that made it difficult to prove a racial homicide case. This part surveys how the Screws case sanctioned the Jim Crow legal system. The debates between civil rights lawyers and federal prosecutors over the meaning of Screws, and the impact of the case on victims on the one hand, and the nascent civil rights legal community on the other. Part 5 features cases from the post-war era in the Birmingham region that illuminate the complex relationships that constituted the Black resistance movement. Black residents of Birmingham, one of the country's most violent cities, had no shield against police violence, but the town was also a hub of Black resistance. In Birmingham, as in other large cities in the South, the NAACP and the local press collaborated to maintain a record of police homicides. In the tradition of Ida Wells Barnett and Monroe work, and hence this part features the work of Emory Jackson, organizer of the NAACP branch and editor of the Birmingham World newspaper. Active in the region as well was the Southern Negro Youth Congress, an organization of young leaders who came together to pursue the agenda put forth in 1937 by the National Negro Congress. The cases in this part suggest how police killings operated both to enforce Jim Crow and to convince whites of the need to maintain it. These killings mythified the bad Negro and united white opinion behind law and order. The part explores the terms of the resistance, perceiving the police and the lynch mob as interchangeable. Black communities deemed law and legal institutions antithetical to their interests. Their opposition to each killing and their insistence on justice held the potential to bring these structural harms into focus and to shift the meaning of power and law. As well, the cases are profoundly compelling examples of the impulse to resist. The defiance of those who lost their lives was perhaps the most formidable and telling acts of resistance. In Part 6, the Southwest region of Mississippi provides a site to examine how Jim Crow erased the crime of kidnapping from the code books where the victims were Black. Kidnapping constitutes a crime against a person, yet until well into the 1960s, law enforcement practices signify that it was not illegal to kidnap a Black person. Traditionally, law has conferred immunities to deprive courts of the right to adjudicate certain kinds of legal violations. Individual immunities, for example, protect judges and prosecutors from suit even when they have violated the law. In failing to prosecute kidnappers, Southern states were, in effect, immunizing their acts, conferring upon them a legal right to do a legal wrong. This part explores the experiences of Black Mississippians who were abducted by whites, both police and private parties, and beaten and often banished, with no legal consequences for the perpetrators. This refusal to appreciate the criminal nature of white-on-black abductions represented a form of common law, constituting a Jim Crow black code. By Hands Now Known concludes with a turn away from the Jim Crow decades to explore early 21st century insights about how states should reckon with historical injustices, such as those narrated in this work. Thus, Part 7 presents some concluding cases from a range of jurisdictions to probe one of the book's central questions: how amends should be made in the present to address long-buried historical harms. It examines arguments for reparations, apologies, truth proceedings, and other mechanisms that could recover this history, offer a platform for communities to confront it, and redesign legal structures that are tainted by the legacies of Jim Crow. Part 1. Rendition. I determined I would never send another prisoner south unless I had assurances he would be protected from the mob and given a fair trial. Cincinnati Common Pleas Judge Morris Lyon Buckwalter, in the Lewiston Daily, January 1, 1895. Shall we let Georgia, who respects no law, return a person, even a woman, to her state where we know she will not receive due process of law under our federal constitution? I say no. I shall, if standing alone, fight to the last ditch any effort on their part to return one of my people to their jurisdiction. Attorney William T. Patrick, writing to Attorney Charles H. Houston, June 2, 1936. 1. A New Version of the Old Story. While much has been written about the feats of escaping slaves and the Underground Railroad that shuttled them to freedom, we know far less about how the paths they forged were picked up generations later by men and women running from Southern sheriffs and courts. These cases, following directly on the heels of emancipation, were ongoing until the mid-1950s. They reveal comparable courage and creativity on the part of the runaways, and, as well, fascinating battles over sovereignty between Northern and Southern jurisdictions and extraordinary collaborations between Northern and Southern black communities. Though the rendition cases read as a 20th century archive about states' rights and black citizenship, the roots of these laws and legal practices lie in antebellum fugitive slave laws. An account of how Jim Crow's statutes and legal practices transported the norms of slavery into the American criminal justice system must begin with Civil War-era rendition. Reverend Anthony Burns was just 28 when, in July 1862, he passed away in St. Catharines, an old Loyalist city on the Canadian side of the Niagara River. 7 weeks later, Abraham Lincoln would issue the Emancipation Proclamation. Born into slavery in the Old Dominion, about 4 miles from the boyhood farmhouse of George Washington, Burns had, in his short life, traversed the continent from Stafford County, Virginia, to Boston, to North Carolina, then on to New York City, where he took to the podiums preaching abolitionism, to Ohio for an education at Oberlin College, and finally to Ontario, where he died of consumption. He had been a schoolteacher, sawmill worker, tailor, minister, and lecturer. As he traveled from the South to New England and from the Midwest to Eastern Canada, he passed in and out of slavery, bound and unbound by the hard borders of geography, bent and unbent by the fraught lines of pre-Civil War politics, sheltered and shielded by the kindness of strangers. At the time of his death, millions knew Burns's story. Some 50,000 had, 8 years earlier, marched in Boston in defense of his liberty, shuttering their businesses, adorning their shops with black flags, and massing to confront the federal troops that convened to ensure his re-enslavement. African Americans, joined by the writer and minister Thomas Wentworth Higginson, armed themselves with a huge battering ram and stormed the courthouse that stood between Burns and his freedom. Burns had been hired out by his owner to work in Richmond. One February morning in 1854, in a brazen plan, he snuck on board a ship headed to Boston. There, the fugitive found work and safety in the tight-knit black community clustered at the bottom of Beacon Hill. He had left behind in Stafford County his mother and 12 brothers and sisters. It was the young man's carelessness, and perhaps his loneliness, a letter written to one of his brothers back in Virginia, that triggered a watershed moment in U.S. history. For Burns's owner, having intercepted the letter, went up to Boston to recover his man. In short order, Burns appeared before a federal commissioner, Edward Greeley Loring, whose judicial task had been, by virtue of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, reduced to that of a notary. Was the man who stood before the commissioner the individual named in the warrant? If yes, he was to be re-enslaved. While the matter was pending before Judge Loring, Boston's militant abolitionists, who had a few years earlier freed the fugitive Shadrach Minkins from jail, rose to the occasion, bringing to bear outright defiance of the law, violent resistance, and negotiation in an effort to win Burns's freedom. Leonard Grimes, the first pastor of the city's 12th Baptist Church and an experienced Underground Railroad conductor, offered to buy Burns from his owner. The Boston Vigilance Committee held a mass meeting at Faneuil Hall, at which Wendell Phillips urged the crowd to break Burns out of jail, while dozens of African Americans, accompanied by Amos Bronson Alcott and Thomas Higginson, went to the courthouse to do just that. These militant efforts fell short. Despite Burns's expressed concerns that a full-throttled legal assault on the Fugitive Slave Act by his lawyers would, in his case, ultimately fail, inflame his owner, and thereby lead to severe retribution when he got back to Virginia, the lawyers plowed ahead, pulling out all the stops. As their client had predicted, the judge rejected their request to act contrary to the clear command of the statute, and about 10 days after his arrest, Anthony Burns was rendered from Boston to Virginia. He did not go easily. As a federal military brigade marched him from the courthouse to the wharf, crowds lined the streets in protest, draping their windows in black and displaying coffins to signify the death of the man's liberty. It was the city's largest anti-slavery demonstration, and the last time the federal government sought to render a runaway back into slavery from Boston. And there were consequences to be meted out to those who, under color of law, had succumbed to Virginia's slaveholders. Judge Loring, whose forebears were pioneers, was removed from a state judgeship and failed to secure a professorship in law at Harvard University. In January 1895, the Cambridge Tribune, in an article titled, "A New Version of the Old Story," recalled the Burns affair for its readers. The new version of the old story was also a rendition case, but this time the rights of the states battling for custody over a black man were governed not by the laws enacted to enforce the Fugitive Slave Clause of the Constitution, the 13th Amendment erased that clause, but by its constitutional neighbor, the extradition clause. Cambridge readers were informed about the decision of an Ohio judge to reject a rendition warrant pressed by the state of Kentucky for the return of one Reverend A.H. Hampton, an African-American who appealed to the court, as had Burns, not to be returned to the South. "Oh, Judge," Hampton declared, "don't send me to Kentucky. I have got letters from my friends telling me that they would string me up." Displaying the courage that had been wanting in Judge Loring, the Ohio judge deemed it within his inherent power to prevent a man being sent back to the South where he could face a lynching. Commenting on the case, the Cambridge Tribune's writer compared the new story with the old one. "If a precedent should be desired in Ohio, the noble action of Massachusetts in 1854 in the rendition of Anthony Burns had not yet quite passed into oblivion, although Burns was only flogged upon his arrival in South Carolina and not hanged, as he had a cash value of $1,500, while the Reverend Mr. Hampton, as a free nigger and therefore of no real value, can be comfortably lynched in Kentucky without pecuniary loss to anyone but his church and his family." As in the case of Anthony Burns, a titanic legal and political battle often ensued over the return of fugitives to slavery. After slavery ended, the strategies conceived to confront these challenges were re-engineered to protect the lives of fugitives from Southern justice, such as the Kentuckian A.H. Hampton. In the post-slavery cases, Northern and Southern Black communities collaborated to prevent the return of a wanted person, and Black lawyers played a prominent role in shaping community protest and legal strategy. These rendition cases forged ties between advocates in small Southern towns and the Northern metropolises to which their relatives and friends had fled, thereby knitting together a national Black community. They provided opportunities for sophisticated advocacy in state and federal courtrooms and in governors' offices. The embryonic civil rights organizations, including the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and the International Labor Defense, took advantage of the intense drama and high stakes of the cases to build membership and fuel their campaigns for federal anti-lynching legislation. Indeed, these cases, together with the anti-lynching crusade, were from the 1920s through the 1940s at the center of the national campaign to expose Jim Crow's criminal justice system. They proffered a dynamic stage upon which Southern and Northern authorities acted out differing conceptions of Black citizenship, states' rights, and due process. The sovereign relationships at issue, state to state, federal to state, although recodified after the war, were still very much shaped by slavery's residuals. Reverend A.H. Hampton's case was one of the most important to emerge in the wake of Reconstruction. It was litigated as the South was consolidating white supremacy in the national courts with, for example, Plessy v. Ferguson in 1896, declaring legally required race separation constitutional, and Williams v. Mississippi in 1898, approving Mississippi's literacy tests and poll tax requirements despite their racially disenfranchising purpose and effect. In an 1878 case, an Ohio court had declared that the state's governor had no discretion to reject an extradition warrant once the identity of the fugitive and the validity of the warrant were determined. But 17 years later, in A.H. Hampton's case, the Ohio court abruptly dispensed with summary review. It appears Reverend Hampton, a resident of Marion County, Kentucky, got into an argument with a white neighbor who had accused Hampton of robbing his orchard. Hampton shot and wounded the neighbor, then fled to Cincinnati, where he was arrested. The Ohio governor and future president, William McKinley, initially agreed to send him back to Kentucky, but Hampton's lawyers, with evidence in hand that their client would probably be lynched if he were sent back, pursued a petition in state court. Morris Lyon Buckwalter, a radical Republican judge on the Cincinnati Common Pleas Court, told the Kentucky authorities that he would not allow the warrant to be executed unless he obtained personal assurances from the Kentucky governor and sheriff that Hampton would not be lynched. 4 months ago, I sent a fugitive from justice into Kentucky. He was lynched soon after he left the train. The authorities broke faith with her sister state of Ohio in the protection of human life. I will not send this man away from this court until I have a letter from your governor that he is to be given a fair and impartial trial. The courtroom was crowded, and some quiet clapping could be heard from the black observers. Moreover, the judge observed, about a dozen people had been lynched in Kentucky in the 12 months that preceded the Hampton case. In the case of Hampton, Buckwalter declared, I determined I would never send another prisoner south unless I had assurances he would be protected from the mob and given a fair trial. When word reached the other side of the Ohio River that radical Republicans were still making demands on the South, the Kentucky governor, John Young Brown, angrily retorted that his self-respect and his regard for the dignity of the state of Kentucky forbid that he should ever give any such humiliating guarantee, whereupon Buckwalter, making good on his word, released Hampton. He reasoned that even though the extradition clause contemplated a narrowly prescribed review of a sister state's demand, the court could withhold approval if the evidence showed that the extradition proceeding was instituted not to prosecute the prisoner for his crime, but to deliver him at a convenient place to kill him in the exercise of individual vengeance. In that type of case, explained Buckwalter, the duty of the judge was to protect the prisoner from such unlawful death. Buckwalter's opinion in the Hampton case affirmed that Northern state court judges had a distinct duty to protect the civil rights of fugitives, prying open for scrutiny racial conditions in the demanding state. It was on this premise that civil rights should guide the inquiries of receiving states, that the racial rights organizations constructed their rendition campaigns in the early 20th century. 2. Mr. Ford's Place. In those northern states where the tracks of the fabled Underground Railroad could still be made out, and where, in the late 19th century, the old abolitionist cause would turn into the fight to fulfill the promises of the Civil War amendments, the refugees' bid for freedom was enthusiastically embraced. From slavery through Reconstruction and the Redemption, continuous communities of resistance undertook highly organized military-style operations to help fugitives make good on their escape and then resettle into their new cities and towns. In places like Detroit, Chicago, and Philadelphia, triangulated historical phenomena, the Underground Railroad, the Great Migration, and black urbanization, primed the sanctuary cities for their role in Jim Crow-era rendition campaigns. In Detroit, Black Bottom and its neighboring streets comprised the Negro District, where migrants from the South could find housing and cultural embrace. This 30-square-block area, named, like the Black Belt, for its fertile topsoil, was the heart of Black Detroit from the early decades of the 20th century until the 1950s, when urban renewal policies and highway construction overhauled the landscape. The area swelled with migrants from the South, including many fleeing to save their lives. Detroit's larger Black community was particularly well-positioned to fight on behalf of fugitives across the 19th and well into the 20th century. During the antebellum years, thousands of runaways crossed the Detroit River into Upper Canada every year, with about 30,000 making the journey between 1842 and 1862. With the abolition of slavery coming to Michigan Territory in 1835, a vibrant Afro-descendant community that included escapees from slavery alongside free Blacks settled on both banks of the river, giving rise to a Black transnational resistance tradition grounded in shared sensibilities about mutual aid and the duty to care for fugitives. These were transgressive, profoundly politicized communities living much like the Maroon communities of an earlier time, in defiance of the laws of slavery and tied together by the attendant risks of these clandestine missions as much as by family kinship and church. Both before and after emancipation, these Michigan liberators had to be savvy interpreters of complex international and domestic law, using to their advantage in the antebellum period, for example, the British rules forbidding slavery in Canada, and then, after the Civil War, mastering the intricacies of federal, state rendition procedures. And when the legal maneuvers ran their course, they had to know how to take direct action. One of the nation's first urban race riots in Detroit in 1833 was ignited by the effort to protect from extradition fugitive slaves Thornton and Lucy Blackburn, a husband and wife who made their way to Michigan from Louisville, Kentucky. Thornton decided to flee with his new bride when he learned she was about to be sold to the New Orleans markets. After 2 years in Detroit, they were captured by Kentucky slave hunters, but Lucy escaped again, this time to the safety of Upper Canada. Detroit's Black community surrounded the jail where Thornton was being held and freed him, leading to the first riot over slavery in that city. Canada successfully resisted Michigan's demand to extradite the Thorntons, whereupon they settled in Toronto and started a taxi business. Thousands of others followed the Blackburns across the river. Many were aided by the All-Black Colored Vigilant Committee of Detroit, founded in 1842 and launched from the Second Baptist Church, the city's oldest Black congregation, which in 1839 established Detroit's first school for Black children. In 1843, hosted Michigan's first convention of colored citizens and offered its pulpit to national abolitionists, such as Frederick Douglass. This stream of freedom seekers swelled after passage of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. Increasing the Black Canadian population from 40,000 in 1850 to 60,000 in 1860. During an 8-month period from May 1855 to January 1856, the Vigilant Committee provided aid to 1,045 fugitives. Shortly after passage of the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, which tightened in favor of the slave states the legal apparatus governing fugitive cases, the matter of Giles Rose, escapee from bondage in Kentucky, came before the federal court in Detroit. Rose was recaptured in October 1850 and confined to the city jail. Unlike Anthony Burns' case 4 years later, the federal commissioner, faced with a militant crowd of Black and white citizens, threw in the towel and let Rose go. The Fugitive Slave Act was essentially unenforceable in Detroit. The Michigan legislature, in 1855, sought to make it even harder for slave hunters to retrieve their bounty in the state by passing a personal liberty law prohibiting state officials from participating in recapture operations and guaranteeing to fugitives a jury trial with legal counsel. These were the tracks that would be dusted off by Detroit activists and lawyers when escapees from Jim Crow justice came knocking on their doors. And these were the stories they would remember as they welcomed them, re-engaging the community's resources and resilience to support a new generation of freedom seekers. Detroit's history of activism during the 19th century, when the Black community was quite small, well prepared it to incorporate over 100,000 migrants from the South during the Great Migration. In 1910, the Black population of the city was about 5,700, while by 1930, it was 120,000, increasing the relative position of the Black community from 1% in 1910 to 8% in 1930. The Black population doubled between 1940 and 1950. A second migration commenced in 1950 and proceeded through the decade, bringing in thousands of additional workers and their families, seeking, as in the earlier decades, to leave the fields behind in favor of the better-paying jobs, Negro jobs, that the auto industry's foundries and paint departments offered. The fight for racial justice tapped into long-standing political traditions in the city. Detroit's NAACP chapter was the largest in the country, claiming by 1943 20,000 members. The legal expertise and national publicity these rendition cases required.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.